2 years back.
Yeah.
We started in 2013 as a very informal event. So in JNU or outside JNU, to any category belongs, like professors, researchers, or students, to come here as those who want to discuss philosophy and subject with philosophy. And we are so privileged to have the first speaker of this workshop, very renowned scholar at Oxford University, from John Hopkins University, and thanks to Francis Manjari, who took the initiative and suggested and invited her for the first colloquium, and this is going to be a great start for this semester. We have actually arranged some guests, like as given in the poster, the tea at 2:30, but then it will come later. We might have seen some developments in the colloquium, some more arrangements and more things, and hopefully we can report for later, maybe things after possibly change. Yeah, and also thanks to the site for the chair of the session. And then I just want to make a few announcements. This is the first colloquium, and there will be another colloquium in the third week of this month by Satya from the English department. This is going to be on Kierkegaard or Shelley, so we have some silent text. And so there are two themes that I will announce later. So then we are planning a workshop at the end of September, a one-day workshop, with various lectures, maybe more than a day, a one-and-a-half-day workshop. And Shomo is talking about Chelsea from the Art Institute, and I, we are planning it together. And inviting people to know the information from the day. And actually based on a talk given by Shomo, this works, I'd like to request from IG Squad to introduce the speaker and then the session.
Thank you, everybody. I have to introduce you to the vagaries of this committee room, because a large, this has been recently renovated. So a large portion of this room has been handed over, except for the four microphones. And those four microphones are strategically placed to be near the speaker and near the chair. So I'm sorry, Professor Das, but you're going to have to stand and address us. So it is usually customary in this kind of occasions, and given the huge turnout, to say things like, Professor Das needs no introduction. But I just want to begin with a little clip. So I've heard Kofi Annan gave a lecture about it, and he was very grateful that he got an introduction, because it has happened to him in the past that, you know, after he stopped being Secretary General of the United Nations, he went to a remote French village and his wife, and he was taking in the pleasure. Except that one day when they went to the grocery store, they saw people looking at him. And he said, "Oh God, my cupboard is blown. And sure enough, 5 minutes later, there were three young men. One of them approached him and said, "Morgan Freeman?" So, though I think there are many of us here in this room for whom Professor Das really needs some introduction, I'm going to give you a little bit of information about her. But I think that, you know, from the side of the JNU community, we would really like to thank you, because even when you're not here, you live in our minds, because we need your work and engagement. So Professor Das is a Krieger Eisenhower Professor of Anthropology at the Johns Hopkins University since the year 2000. But before that, she, as many of us know, taught in Delhi School of Economics. She has received a number of awards, all justifiably so. She got a Guggenheim Fellowship in 2009. The Anders Retzius Award of the Swedish Society of Anthropology and Geography in 1995, and the Bowie Award in 1977. And most recently, she was was awarded the Naseem Habib Prize by the University of Geneva. Professor Das's research covers a whole range of fields. She is passionately interested in the question of how ethnography generates concepts, how we might treat philosophical and literary traditions, which is going to be the subject of a doctorate, from India and other regions, as well as generative or theoretical and practical understanding of the world. How to render the texture and contours of everyday life, and the way the everyday and the event are joined together in the making of the normal and the critical. Her work on collective violence, which has left a tremendous and I think everlasting impact on the way that social sciences is done, been studied in the last 20, 30 years. Work on collective violence on urban transformation has appeared in many anthologies. Her most recent books, and I will only mention the ones that she has authored singly, has appeared in Our Life and Words, Violence and the Descent into the Order in 2007, Affliction, Health, Disease, Poverty, Health, Disease, Poverty in 2015, and there are a number of co-edited volumes today. So welcome to Mr. Das, and we look forward to your lecture.
Reality is not a singular transfer of achievement, which we either reach or fail to reach by the layering of the system of names against the system of objects. Yet the question of the kind of contact between language and reality continues to be the single most pressing issue in what I call the second Wittgensteinian interpretation. Unlike in the Tratados, our experience of how to relate words to worlds in the later work is one of disappointment, for we may succeed and then flounder repeatedly. This is a stance mirrored in the form of writing, especially in philosophical investigations and for certainty, when paragraphs come to an end abruptly and then make a beginning again later, as the same thought reappears with a new example or a different formulation. How then are specific or singular relations to be found between language and reality, or in the way words are found to be word-bound? My basic idea here is to depart from the many discussions that take Wittgenstein's remarks on Frazer as giving us a theory of religion and culture, emphasizing its expressive or symbolic dimension as against Frazer's evolutionary or historical one. Apart from the anthropologists like famously Lord Unigino and Pachacharya, who have emphasized this aspect, among the philosophers is Bouveres, who actually thought that that was the central gravity in the circumstance of the remarks. And what I'm suggesting is that I would like to reflect on issues relating to the internal as distinct from an external relation between language and the world or words. Anthropologists have something important to offer to this conversation, since they too have been deeply engaged with the issues of how to think of language, gesture, and performance in rituals and religion as not simply evidence about how mistaken the primitive societies were about the nature of the world, but something else, be that society, cosmology, concept formation, or efficient as opposed to material causation, as found respectively in Durkheim, for whom it was not error, it was society that represented, Lev Strauss, for whom it was the mind, the Castro, for whom it was the ontology that Putin represented, and Evans Pritchard, famous speaker, for whom, again, it was the symbolic order of the form. More generally, we might ask how to think of the real in relation to what some call semantic opacity of rituals, and others call the grading of the ordinary and the extraordinary in the form of miracles. The concepts that I signal in the title of this paper, mistake, error, and superstition, have some resemblance to each other, but there are also subtle differences between them, of which Wittgenstein gives us a detailed geography. The cases that interest him most, though, are those in which we are misled by our language, either because it captures us within a given picture of the real, or because it was ideal. How are such cases to be brought to the surface of thought? What is harmony between language and the world that is implied here? When is a statement to be seen as a mistake? When an error? When nonsense? When superstition? And what might be at stake in distinction? I do not discuss here the notion of shadow. I think that's a very important notion, but it was connected to thinking far away from the central part of the So I don't take the notion of shadows here. They're always present as the potential of a word, allowing it to move to new contexts. So they do not play exactly the same role as errors and superstitions do, but they do block the notion of a straightforward or obvious way in which words or gestures might be aligned to the world through aspects of reference. Paragraph 465 of Philosophical Investigations, which I've called the voice, says, "My aim is to teach you to pass from a piece of disguised notion, disguised nonsense, to something that is patent nonsense." And I think that's the task that I've set myself. Can we move from disguised nonsense to patent nonsense? What is the nature of the disguised nonsense in Frazer as Wittgenstein sees it? Let us first consider how Wittgenstein makes a distinction between mistake or error and superstition. As distinct from a mistake, Wittgenstein seems to suggest, superstition is something produced through grammatical conclusions. Grammar in the sense of philosophical grammar or criteria that are born within the flesh, leading to the feeling that something that is quite banal or commonplace is really exciting and in need of explanation. One example Charles Davis gives from his topic of investigations is of the child amazed that a tailor could sew a dress, imagining that he had nothing else to work with except his hands and pieces of thread. Thus, a casual expression that a tailor made me a dress becomes the cause of excitement if misinterpreted as the extraordinary event of the dress being produced by sewing, adding one thread on another. This is paragraph 195, and this is the parenthesis comment where Wittgenstein says, oh, I was amazed. I have heard the story of a child being amazed by the fact that a tailor made a dress. So, this question of making it by putting a thread on another without the materiality of the clock. Wittgenstein then seems to fault Fraser, not simply because he read expressive acts as statements of fact, but also because he wrongly added excitement to little acts without seeing what kind of geography or description could provide the scaffold that supports them. I submit that much is at stake here because it misleads Fraser into a direction that turns out to be fatal for understanding how to render cultural difference and situation saturated meaning into a problem for cultural form. Paragraph 194 in PI concludes by saying that, quote, when we do philosophy, we are like savages, primitive people who hear the expressions of civilized men and then draw the queerest conclusions from it. Fraser's superstition then consists in having taken the routine, commonplace appearance of individual complex and added false excitement to it. We shall see what the source of this excitement is a little later. For now, I want to draw out a little more on what it means to think of ritual actions as expressions that are both set apart from the mundane and like yet commonplace. As Michael Lambert has observed, religious utterances, although different from extraordinary utterances or everyday acts, are not extraordinary either, since they entail nothing more than slight shifts and reframing of ordinary speech and ordinary acts. He suggests that we might regard such acts as parasitical or ordinary acts. We could do the other way around too. We could also think that extraordinary acts are actually parasitical acts. Producing what he calls the mystery of the ordinary, in that we can produce this newness, this something other than itself. Let me suggest here a slightly different inflection, taking an example from the conflict of interpretations around a simple ritual gesture for the fulfillment of a wish, and a counter argument that follows between the critics and defenders of the Mimamsa school of Indian philosophy. The critics ridicule the proponents of Mimamsa for such injunction as the one that someone desirous of sons should boil books of gold, much as one boils grains of rice as an offering to be made in a sacrificial ritual. The critics say that everyone knows that grains of rice can be boiled to cook them, and they will satisfy hunger, but not pieces of gold. The reply from the defenders of the Mimamsa is a calm assertion that indeed that criticism holds true for action in the mundane world, but that the injunction pertains to sacrificial action and thus has no relevance for action in the mundane world. What the defenders of the Mimamsa achieve here is to restore calm to what otherwise might have become an argument about the truth or falsity of such ritual action. It's actually very, very interesting how they refuse the question of whether it is true or false, and it shifts the emphasis to something else. I'm suggesting that though we know that the sacrificial vilna is a bounded one, in which actions and expressions are imbued with heightened intensity, they do not necessarily challenge the common background of our everyday life. Consider the following remark. This is remark 23 in the Marx and Fraser that Wittgenstein offers in his criticism of Fraser. I would like to say nothing shows our kinship to those savages better than the fact that Fraser has at hand a word as familiar as ghost. English in the original, that is the pattern of the same German, the word goes to in English, or shade, English in original, to describe the views of these people. And then within parentheses, well, this story is something different from what it would be if it were to describe, say, how the savages imagined that their head would fall off when they have slain the enemy. In this case, our description would have nothing superstitious or magical. Yes, the strangeness of this, this is again Einstein, same character. Yes, the strangeness of this relates not only to the expressions ghost and shade, and far too little is made of the fact that we count the word soul and spirit into our own civilized vocabulary. Compared to this, it is a minor detail that we do not believe that our souls. What I take from this remark is that the familiar word ghost gestures to the fact that an understanding derived from the common background of our lives as humans is implicated in the description of so-called savage customs. The fact that Fraser can use such word at hand as ghosts and shades connects our lives to that of the so-called savages. Their customs can be imagined within our form of life as a human form of life. If, on the other hand, someone had reported that the savage believers that their own heads simply fall off the body when they kill an enemy and are put back when the need arises, we would not know how to relate to such a description and would consider that we were perhaps not of the same flesh, or that the ideas of what our heads and where we belong in the body are perhaps in the description. The Mimamsa scholars were able to preserve the integrity of their everyday when they desisted from saying that boiling pieces of gold were a perfect substitute for gold price. In that case, it would have been perfectly right to add excitement to what was a commonplace in the way it shows what they meant. Let us take one more example of what Wittgenstein means by the harmony between language and word, and in what way Fraser seems to him to have violated a much more important aspect of what we might mean by thinking than simply to have committed an error by mistaking simple symbolic expressions for actual symbols. Consider para number 429, and I quote, "The agreement, harmony of thought and reality consists in this." It's actually a really amazing paragraph. Why? Because he says, if I say falsely that something is bad, it nonetheless isn't right. And I want to explain to someone the word red in the sentence, that isn't red. I point to something. Okay? So, you know, if I'm saying that is in fact to someone who doesn't know what red is, Wittgenstein is taking that as an absolutely interesting example about what it means to think about harmony and reality. So, why? Now I suggest that the point here is that the issue is not if the statement is true or false, according to whether the thing pointed to is red or not, but rather if it could have been red or not. Otherwise said, in speaking of shoes being red, and I'm saying shoes because of Thomas's example of the other shoes being red, in thinking about the harmony, there should be at least the possibility that it could be red. In this sense, a statement being true or false are not states that completely exclude each other. Statements and facts, so to say, are not simply made for each other as gloves and hands are. They are, as Austin said, different dimensions and degrees of success that statements achieve. Part of this depends on whether a space has been prepared for a particular kind of statement or not. In the context of fire festivals, Kirby takes Wittgenstein to be saying that it is the space which the story finds already prepared for it that has to be scrutinized when we consider the sinister character attribute to these festivals in their contemporary enactment, and not only the place which the events themselves might be. So what Fraser fails to understand is not so much this or that fact about the five festivals, but the nature of the problem is supposed to be. See also his paragraph 448, in which Wittgenstein talks about the sentence, "I have no pain in my arm," to ask in what sense does my present painless state contain the possibility of pain.
You know, we know the that he has rotated. The rose has the tiger has rotated. The rose has rotated. He says, but if you were to imagine the roses having deep brown, so the idea that a space of possibility has to be prepared, it's not a question of whether the state is true or false by matching it to something in the real, but whether a space of possibility is prepared for that statement. And now we can understand the important difference and attributes to the fact that Frazer uses words like ghosts or shapes, words that already have a form in our language. A second important theme that makes a considerable impression on Wittgenstein is the deep and sinister character of magic. I don't know how many people know that Wittgenstein had thought that he was going to open his remarks on Frazer by talking about magic, and then he took out a new version, in fact, put him on something with that. What makes magic deep, he asks? Why do we get the sensation of something deep and sinister in the contemplation of human sacrifice? For Frazer, the traces of human sacrifice are particularly clear and unequivocal in the symbolic burning of a specially prepared cake in the Belgian festival. For Wittgenstein, in itself such an eviction, such an evocation of human sacrifice that is supposed to lie at the origin of the festival is Frazer.
And he's referring to the opening pages of the Golden Bough, you know, in which Frazer, having beautifully described his landscape, goes on to say, but it has this sinister feeling of the shadow of these dark times collected in ancient times still falls on this landscape. And Wittgenstein, it's a stone which produces that. There's nothing, if you were just looking at this picture, there's nothing sinister about it, but it's the tone with which he actually presents it. And that's the argument. So why do we get the sensation of something deep and sinister in the contemplation of human sacrifice? For Frazer, the traces of human sacrifice are particularly clear and unequivocal in the symbolic burning of a specially prepared cave in the Belgian festival. For Wittgenstein, in itself, such an evocation of human sacrifice that is supposed to lie at the origin of the festival explains nothing. In order to understand why a deep and sinister feeling is created, we would have to look at present practices and not the prevailing origin of the offering of the festival. Similarly, the explanation, the present practices are not ritual practices at all. Similarly, the explanation that the peace king must be killed in his prime, because according to the notion of the savages, his soul would not be kept fresh otherwise, that impresses Frazer, cannot be made to do much work here. As Zendaya says of this explanation, what should we make of it? According to Wittgenstein, nothing much. And this is the great thing in this, that he leaves a certain sense, which is fact, that something is going to come and be going to say, what should we expect? Nothing much. Instead, we should ask what kind of experiences did such thoughts evoke in Frazer himself. Let us listen to Wittgenstein once again. What I want to say, this is Wittgenstein. What I want to say is this: what is sinister deep about all this does not lie in how the history of this century went. For perhaps it did not go that way at all, nor that it may be or even probably went that way, but in what gives me reason to assume so? What makes human sacrifice so deep and sinister in the first place? For is it only the suffering of the victim that impresses us thus? All manners of illnesses bring about just as much suffering, and yet do not evoke this impression. No, this deep and sinister aspect does not become self-evident just from our knowledge of the history of the external actions. Rather, we impute it to them, reintroduce it into them on the basis of an inner experience of life. This is the remarks of Frazer. I think there are two remarkable things Wittgenstein achieves here. First, he redefines depth, not as a vertical inward depth, but as a spread out into the context. Second, he turns Frazer's interpretations to reflect on what these can tell us about English society through
through the various incipient rituals we construct every day, such as addressing our illness or hitting a rock to punish it. In other words, the reflective gesture that many anthropologists make by asking what the interpretation of ritual tells us about the discursive power or desire of the observer, such as Scott or Cornelli, is evoked here not only to fault Fraser for his interpretation of these rituals, but also to illuminate an aspect of our form as a human form. Returning to the first point, take the concluding sentences of paragraph 43 in Remarks on Fraser. Wittgenstein states, the question is, does this, shall we say, sinister character adhere to the custom of the built-in fire in itself as it was practiced 100 years ago? Or only if the hypothesis of its origin were to confirm it? I believe that what appeals to us as sinister is the inner nature of the practice as performed in recent times. And the facts of human sacrifice as we know them only indicate the direction in which we are moving. When I speak of the inner nature of the practice, I mean all those circumstances in which it is carried out and that are not included in the importance of the festival, because they consist not so much in particular actions which characterize the festival, then in what one might call the spirit of the festival that might be discerned. For example, if one were to describe the kind of people that take part in it, the usual ways of behaving on other occasions, that is the character, and the kind of games they play at other times. And then one would see that what is sinister lies in the character. In other words, I think what is really very fantastic is he does away with the idea of death as anything more. In earlier also in philosophical investigation, when he's talking about death, he's talking about the fact that it's enough. So what is it that language respect ends itself in itself? And is it this is where we might find that it's not really in something virtual. And here I've tried to argue that in the remarks of Fraser, what we get is a very clear notion of his progressionism, namely that for him the harmony between the statements and the world is not in something like what we can find in Mexico, but in the whole of language. The remarkable point here is that the experience is not located in the vertical depth of the subject, but in the dispersal of activities. The saturation of meaning by recounting of what constitutes context here. Note that Wittgenstein is not bringing up only certain features of language, individuals of the Mexicans, as connecting language to the world, but is positing the character of worldliness or context saturated character of language as a whole. If further support were needed for this point, we could read Pierre para number 652, in which, taking the sentence, he measured him with a hostile glance and said. Wittgenstein asks how a reader of a narrative in which the sentence appears, yes, is there, who supplies the meaning of the sentence. After all, the narrative might show that the hostile glance later turned out to be pretense, or the reader may be kept in suspense about whether or not these words are as the reader is challenged to guess as a possible interpretation. But then the main thing he guesses at is context. In other words, ordinarily we just take the words to mean what they say, but when confronted with a doubt whether these two men are friends or enemies, then what we have to guess is not the meaning of the words, but the context. In order to discern why the fire festivals create a feeling of dread in their modern enactments, we would have to discern the spirit of the festival and not simply particular ritual gestures. The second point regarding the similarity between our customs and theirs is well illustrated in the example we mentioned this of our kissing the picture of the beloved, not because we have an error in thinking that the picture is a loved one, but because it satisfies the wish. Remark makes this clear. Burning an effigy, kissing the picture of a loved one, this is obviously not based on a belief that it will have a definite effect on the object which the picture represents. It aims at some satisfaction and does achieve it too. Or rather, it does not aim at anything. We act in this way and then we feel satisfied. I cannot pursue the theme of what being satisfied tells us. And those of you who like to read the recitations, right? People all or people who
you know, all the examples about whether or not the machine, you know, the meter feels satisfied on receiving the, you know, the fed, the coin. And why is it that questions like expectations expect to be satisfied, but they cannot be satisfied? So I'm not going to go into that in further detail, but it's a very, very interesting point he's making. So I can't pursue this except to say that that the relation between say a wish and its satisfaction and expectation and its fulfillment or its execution, except to state that no further evidence as to the truth or falsity of such statements are asked for. And that Wittgenstein gives us a whole range of examples in which it would be absurd to say that an error was committed, since these are not, in the first place, matters of opinion and cannot thus be true or false. In drawing connections between our practices and those that Fraser evokes as evidence of primitive mentality, Wittgenstein's aim is to arrive at what he calls the perspicuous arrangement. P.I. makes the case that the perspicuous representation produces just that understanding which consists in, quotes, interconnections, and the case of finding intermediate cases. The effort that Wittgenstein makes in arranging the cases in a way that we can see connections has the effect of taking away the excitement that superstition adds to what might be denial actions or those expressions of these mathematical conditions. But even more, his further achievement is to suggest that there is a background of common sense that we might identify as part of the very human, part of the human way of life. But here we must pause and ask what question of human conforms in life. The best guide for making a way through this question is not the universalism of the benefits in the debate, but the frequent references to the natural history of mankind, which are related quickly to a very embodied creature and creatures who are alive in competition. P.I. 25 says, commanding, questioning, recounting, chatting are as much part of the natural history as walking, eating, drinking, away. Thus, what we do as embodied creatures, walking, eating, with this time, because what we do as embodied creatures, walking, and as creatures who are alive in mankind, recounting, are not laid along the axis of nature and nature, but rather on the axis of a natural history of man. Finally, consider one of the last three passages in the Bible. Quote, if the formation of concepts can be explained by facts of nature, should we not be interested, not be grand, but rather in that in nature, which is the basis of grammar. And then he said, and this is very common strategy with the standard, you know, which is to offer a temptation and then have the next thing quashing that, or at least trying to behave in the place where the temptation is. And one of the problems with a lot of interpretations, at least by anthropologists in the channel, that they don't realize that there is a conversation of several voices in the temptation. Sometimes you would pick up something excited in the channel without actually worrying about which kind of voice. So many times our interest certainly includes the correspondence between concepts and very general facts of nature. Such facts as mostly do not strike us because of their generality. But our interest does not fall back upon these possible causes of the formation of concepts. We are not great natural science, yet not natural history, since we can also invent fictitious natural history. And our point is that this fictitious natural history that we invent would nevertheless have to be in harmony with the word. So that's why his example that we can use words like ghosts and spirits, and it doesn't matter that their spirits eat and drink and our spirits don't eat and drink, but we cannot posit a natural history in which the Jerica who fills up the lawyer falls off, they don't get any more. Because it would violate the certain common background of life. The ideas here are of rightness, fitness of our expressions carrying greater natural weight in a way that we might not feel that the language and words are in harmony with each other. That's how we choose and value words. It's not about having a common framework for interpreting the meaning of what is said, but what the person means in saying. The sense in which one's words are an expression of what matters to one and the rightness in relation to the world of organisms that Wittgenstein alludes to in reference to forms of life refers in part to what Act Austin characterized as made possible by our own language,
because it embodies all the distinctions that I found worth drawing and the connections that I found worth making in the lifetime of many generations. And partly because we share a sense of the natural, as an Austin example, that I cannot say, I stepped on the planet in the it is not that the sentence is not the natural, but the words cannot be made from the name, but the sense of life that puts the problem sense of it in such constructions. It violates a sense of what is the natural start of the structure. Instead of one step, I stepped on the giant accident. That would be a possible construction for such accidents. Here, Austin shows the intimacy between the language and the word by bringing expression and harmony into action, what alludes to distinctions inadvertently and accidentally, and then when often it's been mistaken by accident, etc. As natural to our way of being. What I've tried to do here is not to give a chronological account of what I think are similar concepts that link our understanding of different forms of life and the form of life as human, but rather to say that Fraser provided an important provocation to Wittgenstein as to how we might see other forms of life as both ours and theirs, much as our own form of life, for the natural and the social, modes of living and modes of dying in culture. In my own remarks on the specific paragraphs or remarks from Fraser that have been assigned to me in this connective exercise, I will try to say how attunement and absorption in the world through our agreements in our forms of life does not exclude the idea that we might have been otherwise than we are. And this register of the subjunctive, what the subjunctive means, particularly in the way of the remains of rituals and methods, through bringing Wittgenstein into anthropology. So I'll just give you a sense of the flavor of it. So remark 27. It's a very interesting remark. It says, I could imagine that I might have had to choose some being on earth as my soul's dwelling place, and that my spirit had chosen this unsightly creature as its seat and vantage point. Perhaps because the exception of a beautiful dwelling would have been true. Of course, for the spirit to do so, he would have to be very sure of himself. Right? This is very hard to interpret as compared to, you know, kissing the picture of your beloved or so this is how it seems to make sense to be in relationship to your So here's my point. Zagorka makes a point that in suggesting that depth is not about inward depth but about connections, Wittgenstein spreads out subjectivity into context, resulting in the radical move of dissolving the question of artisan subject. Similar to the imagination that my pain could be in other bodies, Wittgenstein is also provoking us to imagine that the boundaries of our body are not the boundaries of the subject. Our existence is always capable of being more or other than its present realization. For all our worldliness then, we might never be fully at home in the world. Might one then think of ritual as one way of imagining what the world is? In my reading then, this thought would morph into the deep skepticism that might destroy my everyday life, or it might show the ability to imagine a different everyday, or an eventual everyday, as part of the actual present day. How have anthropologists addressed this problem of the subjunctive mood? A promising move is made by Seligman et al., who start a substantive chapter on ritual and the subjunctive by declaring that ritual creates a shared and conventional world of human sociality, but that such a world is always subjunctive, just one possible. But I'll not go into greater detail. What is fascinating in their analysis is the manner in which they try. I mean, they're committed because I think many of these were scholars of ancient China. That the world is a horrible place. And so when the ritual presents a kind of harmonious something or the other, like the thing that I think that the harmonious etc., it's not making such a not making a statement about the world. It is making a statement that the world could have been otherwise, even though they know that it will not. So that's the register in which I interpreted this. So, so for example, one of the things they argue is that the world of polite interactions, for example,
you know, I say to the kid, please come to the hospital. So, I mean, the kid knows jolly well. He may say once, no, I won't. And I say, please, back me over. No, I won't. You better pass on the story or else. So, you know, the friction dissolves at that. But my point is that nevertheless, we don't know when this subjunctive worship actually comes at you. And this is something which it seems to me is part of the question over here, you know, in which, because for Seligman and all the Hobbesian world of war, of, you know, of one against the other is the human. Whereas I've argued that that's as much a picture as the world of the Chinese material tries to create this notion of harmony. In Wittgenstein's account, possibility was the space prepared for a particular statement or story to find a footing. It's not simply an alternative to actuality. So that, I think, is a very important thing, that in a certain sense, he's not saying over here that this is just an opinion, but that actually it depends on this question, having been there. How might then such a story as imagining a myth of origin for oneself, in which one's decaying of one's identity of what one's spirit has chosen, as the best picture, the best dwelling place for itself, to find it for the language? Are the senses of the subjunctive, or the I could imagine in Wittgenstein's remarks on phrase are different. Ahead I argued that indeed both accounts address the issues of how the inner and the outer are stitched together, but take us to fairly different directions.
If you permit me, I'll read just one more remark.
So remark 28. One could say every group has its chunk. But that would be wrong. This is a good question. What is correct is that every view is significant for whoever sees it so. But that does not mean sees it as something other than it is. Indeed, in this sense, every view is really significant. Yes, it is important that I must make my own, even anyone's, contempt of it, as an essential and significant part of the world seen from my country. It's the theme here relates to how one might make one's life significant to oneself, or in Stanley Cavell's signature idea, what is it to find one's voice in one's own culture? Sandrologia argues that whereas for Wittgenstein the central question was the common use of language, Cavell makes a new question arise from that problematic, that of the relation between an individual speaker and the linguistic community. I cite her, for Cavell this leads to a reintroduction of the voice in the phrase.
You know, in an interview, I think Cavell was asked, what is the most significant thing about the voice? And he said, it's to introduce the human voice.
He's speaking to the mic.
Yeah, so he said, it's to introduce the human voice in the philosophy. So in some ways, when people think that this is ordinary language philosophy in the Russell, for instance, there is a real problem, because there is in a certain sense, for this particular lineage of scholar, there is a question of how, in a certain how to overcome the grammatical delusions created by the metaphysical voice, and thereby be able to understand.
So she thinks for Cavell, this leads to a reintroduction of the voice into philosophy, and to a redefinition of subjectivity in language, precisely on the basis of the relationship of the individual voice to the linguistic community, the notion of her voice to the voices. In remark 28, the issue is not of establishing the relation of my body and my soul, or alignment between them alone, but also of seeing singularity between the domain of culture. Every view is to be found in a given form of life, requires significance, as it is made part of one's own disposition, or one's mental position in one's culture, but not when seen as if in a catalogue of beliefs testifying to the internal pluralism or internal heterogeneity of culture. It is important to note that what is at stake here is not a parabolic insistence of the significance of one's existence or the uniqueness of one's experience, as in Cavell's famous discussion, but surely you cannot have this thing, the re-dramatization of experience. And he's saying that that's not where the question of what matters to me is found. Rather, the insistences on the waking, on making the work of my, is on the work of making my voice count, on taking the facts of my existence upon myself. In saying that taking someone else's contempt for myself as part of how the world is for me,
I address to my city government. I'm particularly interested here in pursuing the thought of what it means to take the facts of my existence upon myself through aligning myself to ritual performances, whether it is secular. One way we could approach this question is by asking what is it for one to be attached to the words one utters, the gestures one makes, and thus taking an external performance as a testing of an internal state. Hostet famously saw a promise as the outward and visible sign, initially read so for convenience or for some similar reason that was read as indicative of an inward and spiritual act. From there he said it was a short step to assume that the outward utterance is a description, true or false, of the appearance of the inward act. Thus, for instance, we begin to ask if the person promised to come back tomorrow meant his words or not. Austin's point, of course, was that at least as far as the evolutionary force was concerned, the officiating priest did not have to be sincere in declaring someone an animal act. So the external performance was not stitched to an inner state of sincerity. If all the conventions were in place for the marriage to be accomplished, his words would accomplish it. If such utterances, such as making a promise, were to be regarded as the prototype of what is the utterances, then collective performances would not have to be translated to any evidence of inner attachment. Then the kind of pressure would be chance to be on making my own, the viewpoints I have found within my way. But matters are, of course, not. First, as the well brilliantly demonstrated, there are different moments in the performance of such ritual enactments as a magic marriage ritual. It may be sufficient for the presiding priest to utter the correct formula without raising issues of sincerity or attachment to those words. But the man who says I do can better not be a witness who intends to cheat the value of the characters. In other words, if we take something like I promise and think about illusionary force, clearly yes, it is presiding in the words of the priest. But there's also the guy who says, I promise, or the woman who says, promise. And in fact, it's only time we will tell whether or not that state, you know, that particular statement has been felicitous or not. And from that, I want to argue that in that the description, I mean, there are bridges between the circumstances. In formal ways, we identify the treatment by saying, conditioning forces, when you do something in sense. But in fact, if we dismantle this into the micro act, then in a certain sense, what we get is a certain kind of bridge between the illusionary and the illusionary force. Okay, one last one. Remark 29. If a human being were free to choose to be born in a tree in the forest, then there would be some who would seek out the most beautiful or highest tree for themselves. Some would choose the smallest, and some would choose an average or below average tree. And that I do not mean out of philistinism, but for just the reason, or the kind of reason, for which some has chose the highest. That the feeling we have of our life is comparable to that of a being that could choose its standpoint in the world has, I believe, is based on the myth of belief that we choose our bodies. My remark here is based on my somewhat shaky and intermittent understanding that Wittgenstein is using a philosophical allegory to contest the Cartesian allegory in which I am able to doubt if my body is mine, but not if my mind is mine. So there are two very interesting things in very clearly in the Cartesian performance of doubt. He's very clear that it does not attach. Right? So if Charlie is dead, that's a pretty good impact. I mean, if somebody was alive or dead and you say this is so and so, right, it's really not correct. I cannot do this. And the fact that the Cartesian doubt is performed to the first person is not saying that the world is but how do I know why it exists? And what's interesting, as Elizabeth Unsworn and others have shown, is the fact that in some ways there is a certain sense in which the Cartesian split between the first person and so I offer the suggestion that we could learn something about how Wittgenstein's remark on TI of the human body being the best picture of the human soul might be illuminated through a comparison with the intimate relations he posits between a word and its meaning. Para 1530 in PI speaks about imagining a language in which use of the soul of the word is based on the body. Right? So he's talking there of the word
birds have souls. It's an ocean, very different birds have very different brain.
And he says, in which, for example, we have no objection to replacing one word by another, arbitrary one mention. But this paragraph immediately draws comparison with Wittgenstein's evocation of the people who are soul blind, and Wittgenstein's pointing out to the feeling we have for the physiognomia of words. Our relation to our body then is not simply that of imagining it as an arbitrary relation, any more than we can simply replace one word by another by consulting a dictionary, almost as if a voice. What then should we make of the last line of the Mark 29? I believe what is being suggested here is that our feelings about the rightness of our bodies are somehow fitting for us similar to our feelings for the life as a whole, not simply the rightness of this or that action that we perform.
And that's a very long book on this question of what for Wittgenstein's ethics as a feeling for emotions. So what about the fact that in many cases techniques of the body are about our bodies being able to be expressions of other bodies, such as the bodies of animals or bodies of plants, as in many yoga postures. For that in Amerindian mythologies, humans might make their home in human bodies or in animal bodies. Of course, if our relation to our body might be that of having to contain or release the animal that is housed in it, as in all talk of animal spirits, then there should be no difficulty in imagining that they are also human beings.
In other words, what I'm saying is that what is very interesting to me is that we have no difficulty in imagining that an animal lives in our body. But we do have difficulties in imagining that a human could actually be a human being.
And with this, and in a certain sense, opening up the kinds of horizons to think that our feelings are our body.
But that feeling of our body could be for, a man to ever, take about moment form female characters in dance, might have a feeling for his body as a female body. And it seems to me, therefore, that that if Marx, which initially I thought I do not know how I'm going to find it, but it opened up this door for really thinking about the fact that in Wittgenstein, the question is not that you escape, you escape the everyday of something. But that you imagine, in a certain sense, what is it to imagine that you're not human? What is it to imagine that you could be a human being, which actually allows for him the possibility, which ends on number 30. I believe the characteristic feature of primitive man is that he does not act on the basis of opinions. And we have to remember that this connects up with the I paragraph 21. So you are saying that human agreement decides what is true and what is false. It is what human beings say that is true and false. And they agree to the language they use. And then the crucial thing, this is not agreement in language. That is to say, the notion then that something like criteria is not a matter of having propositions to which we can attach notions of true and false, but thinking what is it that might come between this notion of truth and false, truth and figure of possibility, and thereby imagining in a certain sense that there have been a lot of debate on whether a form of life should be called a consumer or a plural, and the fact that it only occurs once in the plural, but the fact that a form of life anyway occurs only six times in the entire succession of situations. But it seems to me that there's something very, very interesting in the propagation that in trying to imagine in a certain sense, because remember, Wittgenstein never ever referred to any of these tribes. So, of course, he has many tribes in himself, but they're all imaginary. Never ever, unlike say, Donald Greer, who has written on the proof, for example. Wittgenstein did not do that. And that, it seems to me, that what we are interested in there is precisely this notion of whether the criteria might also allow us to, in a certain sense, staying within the form of life, imagine it sometimes. And I'll stop over there because it seems to me that it's, Antoine just something very good to say, oh, you don't understand, what Fraser was trying, even when they completely
Now there is that suspicion in a certain sense, increasingly in fact. Whereas it seems to me that in a certain way the entire exercise of trying to understand in some depth, what is it that you say, and not transcending into some very general language to just say that no thing outside of a language to social language to such. I was about to say nonsense, but I think it seems to me that that's where something very interesting arrives in a, fact, in a kind of conversation.
Translation being done by translators because I don't speak German. So I would like to know from you whether you would like to have a pluralistic interpretation of human forms of life or a single interpretation.
The idea that I've tried to show is the question elsewhere, then there is a double dimension of form and matter. Kavel thinks that has the horizontal and the vertical dimension, so that he takes the vertical to be referring to the biological. I've argued that it's much more than the biological, because it's a question where he can talk about whether words have life. There, obviously, it's not a question of biology. It's a question of a certain, if you can take out vitalism or animation from a vitalistic philosophy, there is this double movement that you could have thought, which is life, which is death. Okay. So in a certain way, when he's talking in the last paragraph, saying, and before that he's had this notion of what is a concept for him. A concept for him is something as simple as a chair. Right? And he says we should make our concept as simple as chairs and tables and lamps. Right? So in that sense, for him, the crucial question seems to be, what would it mean to be talking about facts that are part of our background of life as human? And therefore we can invent natural history, but in that invention of natural history, we cannot violate the sense of the human. Yet the human needs form, life needs form to be grounded in. Right? So then you always get a sense that in this corner of humanity, life looks like this. So that if you were to compare it with, say, Heidegger's notion of what I'm saying, in a certain sense, Heidegger is trying to say this is the form human existence can take, which is why he would reject something like context as saying only a part. And so in that sense, it seems to me the question is never like as if we knew, I mean, you could say, is there an Indian form? I don't know what that would mean. It's a question of where exactly do criteria go from? And for him, I think that's the crucial. Which brings me to this issue of similarity. So I want to add that through Kavel and Nozier first, and then my understanding of that. So for Kavel, his entire corpus is in a certain sense to say that when I say this is my life, it's a feeling for my life. It's a question of can I make it matter? And the importance of the Cartesian moment is, of course, that the Cartesian doubt is performed in the first person. So Elizabeth Onscombe writes and says that no one has taken up the question, why is it the first person? And one could then say that it's really this question of the darkness of the first person, that the first person is not a pronoun at all, right? Because it can never be thought of as a basic thing. You know, how beautiful thought experiment that you could have. B to Z for the back. And A, suppose I didn't say I. Everybody else can talk to me, have a little say, please, this, that. In order for me to speak about my feelings, I would have to say A, please, that. And it shows what a weird experiment that ends up in. Because, of course, I am not somebody who I will lay aside and try to fight. And so, in a way, this question becomes, so there's no simple first-person perspective, which is what anthropologists call it, and now I say, oh, this is a first-person perspective, but that adds to the question. So then the individual question becomes both as saying that that what criteria I grow with, both are a gift and are a review. They can be reviewed because then, unless I have those, I cannot review. I'm not sure whether they recognize what's my life or what is it that is my life. So it's neither that the individual appears at the moment of resistance, nor is it the Foucauldian subject, which is created primarily through experience. It actually goes further into thinking of what kind of work would it require for me to be able to speak the I. And that's why, form of life and this question of singularity is very, it will retain the sense of contingency, not that, oh, there is something pending which is being right from the start. It's a work that has to be from. And in that work, Kavel's essay on Asters and his, his creation of a thankfulness to the black problem from he learns to say, the idea that American culture actually learns to sing in a philosophical sense because of the presence of God. It seems to me that that's the kind of direction where I find this question to be much, much more interesting and truer to the transcendental notions. So one would have to go out from saying, oh, this part of it is social, this part of it is natural, because in a certain sense, there is an essential folding of the natural and the social in the sense that this makes sense as a human, but we don't have the luxury of thinking that we know what the human is.
Questions? So we'll take like this two or three questions.
Thank you very much, Ms. Das. I wanted to actually go back to thinking about ritual and myth in the subjunctive mode, because also in your very first book, Structure and Cognition, it is something that is being explored through those Purans as well. Firstly, the idea that, and what you also alluded to here when you talked about scholars writing on Chinese rituals, as offering actually in those models of harmony a possibility. And I know in earlier work you said maybe even to keep the horror at bay, the horror of the everyday or the real at bay. But it's something that you tackle very differently in Structure and Cognition. It's a way also maybe you're thinking about a society that is changing or is in the process of churning, where identities are dismantling and forming, etc. And in that context, you think of these Purans as offering a possibility and another where a subjunctive can be or can be read in the subjunctive mode. I wanted you to just say a bit more on that, both with myth and with
myth.
So, yeah.
I mean, one way this idea that some societies or some periods are very volatile and other periods are very peaceful is something which I've somehow come to doubt more and more. For the reason that if conceptually the idea of the possibility of the human is a fragile possibility, then that means that there's that the threat of skepticism contemplated in different kinds of ways. Right? So one of the best examples of that might be books. Or Karadhanman's notion that people might be using concepts as if the world and the concepts are in harmony, but in fact, the concepts might have lost all their background conditions, in which case there is a trance-like character to the point. My slight departure from Seligman, Kuwait, etc., is that for them, ritual then becomes this bounded thing, although they're also playing with the idea that something like politeness is itself subjunctive, in practice manners or civility, etc. So, in a certain sense, one would have to think in what kind of way the indicative and the subjunctive are completely woven into each other. And to that extent, it's not just that, oh, when the world is terrible, I begin to imagine nicer things, which is a very sensitive notion. Although the idea that the world is terrible could become a structure of eventuality. That's what happens in waiting for the barbarians. The barbarians do not come, but they've already created a particular structure of eventuality within which, within which everything that formed is in a certain sense. So I would think that there is, that there's something very deep in the way in which subjunctive is consistently arises in Kral and in China and Russia, which is not a denial of the actual, but the words that have to be formed. Whereas in poetic people, it becomes like an escape. That also gives us, you know, some, that's why I was very impressed in a way by the form of debate in the concert, or the notion of, you know, something like Kami in Anuvartan. Because for them, and it's very interesting that for them, something like metaphor is, Pratitya is a lower form of aesthetic pleasure, because the exact word is it takes the actual meaning, and the actual meaning becomes illustrative, that is, humiliated. Right? Metaphor humiliates everyday meaning. Whereas the notion of money is that it resonates from it, but it does not itself. And, you know, in logic, they use the notion of the lamp and the light, where, unlike the relation between lightness and dark, where the light would expel darkness, the lamp and the light are both registers in the region. Right? It's that particular register on which it seems to me that probably the Indian philosophical traditions were very much more attuned. And the reason why Wittgenstein's writing appears so peculiar to a lot of Western scholars is because, you know, there wasn't a place for this.
This is a very technical discussion that we presented here, Wittgenstein's remarks on Fraser's work. It's very difficult for me to kind of talk about that. But I just want to see the general kind of paradigm that he seems to be working on from Wittgenstein, beginning with Wittgenstein's works. So I can see very well that there's a clear shift from using structuralism in clear shift from using structuralism in anthropology to using pragmatics, speech act theory, the idea of use of language and so on. That's clear in the kind of work that you've been doing, where you talk about wording the world. That's your term. Yeah, I know. I have the book here, the book, The Festschrift, which she has written for you. The difficulty here, as far as I can see, is that somewhere or the other, we take the world for granted. No, you don't take it. Or you take the world for granted. Now, or you take life for granted. You don't take any of these three. Alright. So then, I would have thought you do take it for granted. But how does one address the constant instability in domains before one can talk about forms of life? How does one actually do it? This is the problem that... this is the problem that one should always address to Wittgenstein.
I mean, so one thing is clearly that Wittgenstein is saying that there is a disease in philosophy, and his whole attempt is to try and offer a therapy for that great problem. So clearly something like the general paradigm wouldn't, you know, it's the form of it is not Wittgenstein. But the task then, in a certain sense, becomes precisely the way in which one is in media arrest, one falls in the middle, and then the question becomes what is the tenderness in relationship to that. Which is why if you take, so Austin is not Wittgenstein, in fact, but what you get from Austin is this is this attentiveness to the minute differences, that unless we have a geography of the various ways in which instances might be generated, we do not understand the various ways in which human vulnerability. So something like vulnerability and fragility is absolutely absolutely essential to any description. And the task when Wittgenstein says, you know, do not think, look and see, that question of what does it mean to look and see is a very, very hard question. Because of course, something like everyday life, as he says, you know, is most difficult because of your eyes. Which is why, of course, in imagination, I have to imagine, if I imagine everyday life as the master, then I will see threats to it. Maybe in terms of infidelity, maybe in terms of coarse kind of emotions. I have a paper calling Household Defense where I try to show how a certain absurdity might be created, both a certain eventuality and absurdity might be created, by absolutely recalling totally Household Defense. And so that, in a certain sense, is the kind of task which which he would accept in some ways for the question of how even something like concepts are to be generated. It's not like we can critique something like super concepts and so your notion of concepts or super concepts. But really what we need to do is not, because he's so hostile to the idea that we can have a system of competition and lay on something like So the notion of the real itself becomes very, very challenging. And the question is constantly, how is that secure? Which is why Cabell comes to the notion that, the problem with a lot of people when they thought about skepticism was that they thought that the task force to overcome skepticism was in force. And he says, no, we're not allowed to either win or lose against it. We're not able to put down our mechanism and say, what can we do? Everything is enough. Nor can we just say, oh, now we have got the final proof and we can make the rest. So there's the issue, of what my picture of the work that we perform is to offer the notion of essentialism, which was completed with the fact that I think it's not a big, massive battle of good versus evil. That I would say is the question of transcendence, so that's not how I want to use it. But there is a certain question that our tendency to violence against the everyday has been part of this. And so, what would it mean to actually try and even identify how we find out in the manner of the world? And to that extent, I would say that what it then asks for is very different. Which do not look for super concepts and super distributions. Well, it's a great deal, it is the master of mathematics, not that abstraction. But just as logic is not something, it's not even two examples there. Logic is again something where he will talk of a logical spirit. And he can imagine, he can go to a tribe and he says, suppose you went there and you found that everybody believed that 2+2 was 5. You're not going to say, oh, is 2+2 4 or is it 5? Is it relative? Should we say for them it's 5 and for us it's 4? Or would you say maybe they have a different notion of calculus? Maybe what we call addition is not what they call addition. Right? It's that kind of calming voice that I find actually really interesting. Which is why I think the notion of superstition appears only twice in investigations, appears, I think, 3 times in certainty. But you can put that along with the error of scale and all sorts of shallowness. And then you get a geography of where the fragility both in us and in the world. And the world is not taken for granted precisely because, in a certain sense, the crucial distinction there is between state and affairs. And the question of the world would be the limits of the subject to ask the world. It becomes a question of what is it to make the world by. I don't know if I'll try to answer it, but it's a different job for
yeah.
It was a very interesting and engaging presentation that you made. There's no more of a clarificatory question. I think in my reading of Mathilal's Mind, Language and the World, he in an essay where he talks about the anthropologist's position that you could go and study a tribe and their rituals and report about them, take description, but you cannot, anthropology takes the position that I talk about it, but I do not necessarily believe in it. So, Mathilal, reviewing the Indian philosophical traditions, he says such a position is not possible, in these Nyaya and other traditions, because the moment you say you've studied, you've got involved, and to say it could only be a secondary attitude. And there he ends the essay. So the position that anthropologist states that I could study any ritual, but without believing in what is being done. I'm sure you have thought about it and you addressed it in various ways in your presentation.
I think that was a kind of compromise, early 20th century kind of notion. And the reason why it was a kind of position was because the text actually in itself had contradictions. So I think it is a very good example. He said very clearly at one end, of course we know which is from now. How do you know it? He doesn't tell us. But there is a particular place in the Noah, in Azande, which perhaps is talking about the book. When, one day he's sitting in his cottage and he suddenly sees this light moving. And he begins to think, oh, that's the wind moving. And then he kind of scolds himself, what am I doing to give him the same way? And then, he finds the next day that actually in that, perhaps someone will die. And then he says, oh, so maybe there's a wind moving. That skepticism, in fact, become the official position, say at the time of, Prabhupada didn't take a position. Prabhupada in many ways was saying no rituals are, I do not believe in any ritual. Not just their ritual, but nothing. This is really just a symbolic formulation of society. And a lot of people then begin to say, no, this is the work, there is a trick over here. So, you might want to look at the very fantastic books like Prabhupada's others. Dead words or shilling. Where she started constructing. How did you reason that once you're into this world, there's no question whether you believe in good. You are in the world. And so you can't just step aside and say, now I can describe it to you as if I know. She says, I don't believe in the government, whether it exists, it doesn't exist. This is how it affects. And this is how it affects. In the way we imagine. So, I think the question over here, and the question is why would I need to declare, first and foremost, whether I believe in it or I don't believe in it, because people themselves are very divided. There are times when they say, yes, I think this is so, and there are times when they say, no. Even among the Azande, heaven would be very clear that there are some people who say, I don't know. And others will say, no, I have evidence. So then the question or the structure of description shifts from that. And once you come to the ontological term, then this entire question, that's why that was my reference to the fact that one is so difficult to believe that there might be humans in kind of bodies. It makes sense if I live in a society in which the jaguar is my brother in law. Otherwise it's just an intellectual saying, but if I'm living with animals in that way, then it becomes something different because it's done through the thickening of everyday life, even though it comes to have little and very interesting point, even for science. But what is it, when is it that something that we really gathers weight and not keeping it is there at the start? So this issue is a much, stresses really in a certain sense on the question that's gone far beyond the question of religious and religious.
Sometimes I think that the notion of Wittgenstein, which
is there in philosophical investigation, and the notion of Heidegger, especially post-Kennedy, what is thinking on time and being, and of philosophy and task of thinking composite. And Charles Taylor has written a long essay on this thing.
Sorry?
And Charles Taylor has also written a long essay on this thing. What is your point?
Well, you know, clearly, in a certain sense, if one things like Putnam or Cavalli that Heidegger and Wittgenstein are, in a certain sense, the two greatest philosophers challenge the normal way in which philosophy is done, there would be a sense in which there are points about thinking. My difficulty is, of course, that one part of my difficulty is the fact that in relationship to for both Heidegger and for Wittgenstein, quite clearly something like everyday life is the ground, it's of central importance, but it's also not the ground in a foundational sense. Right? Part of the difficulty of interpretation seems to me that, you know, given the fact that being at time is something which, you know, belongs to Heidegger's earlier period, and he's supposed to go back to the question of ecology at the time. But nevertheless, there is something very interesting in the way in which they come close and where is it that the divergence is. For example, it's very clear that, say, something like everyday talk for Heidegger is at one point it is necessary because it gives some witness, but at other points you need to transcend it. And Kant put it very well, I think, when he said that, you know, that for Heidegger, the thing that you never find in any struggle with any evidence that you've ever struggled with the existence of a single concrete thing. Maybe even Wittgenstein did not, then of course, then I am not. But it's something several scholars are trying to work on. I mean, it'd be very hard for one to say yes or no unless one is specific question. So just to take one question, you know, what's the picture of the other? With Heidegger, it's very clear that the other is someone who could be me. When Wittgenstein is constantly saying that the notion that the other presents a metaphysical definition is what we need to do. So I'm much more interested in the specifics of it, you know. Wittgenstein and method would make it impossible for me to just say, oh yes, I can say in general terms that this is what was common with Wittgenstein. Having a great, you know, defeat the entire.
One question, and then we close the meeting.
Yeah, I really enjoyed. I don't know whether I understood much of it, but I enjoyed. I was just thinking of if we could, in terms of anthropology, again coming back to anthropology and the implications of the fluidity that you are talking about, the correspondence and non-correspondence between the word and the real. How does one look at these implications in terms of, say, writing, ethnography writing? You did talk about, you know, writing in say mid-20th century, and since then, you know, a lot has changed, and experimental writing and all that. But still, I think if you could talk more about, in methodological terms, how anthropologists can take it forward.
I mean, there's no formula, right? I mean, if there was a formula, you know, there'd be no problem. It's a question. So one of the things that's very important is, I take from Wittgenstein, is the question of what is it that matters to? And what is it to give expression to what matters? And if it is that what is it to give expression to what matters, then cannot by definition have to. Now, I do understand that you write, you send your article to journals, and I say, oh,
you know, this is unfortunately, this is very interesting, but it's not really anthropology. Or, you know, fortunately, anthropology hasn't yet reached the thing where the science journal will say, this is not written in the I think that was a historical question in itself. That is very clear if you look at the history of the scientific paper. That how people wrote a scientific paper in the 19th century, way different from how they write a scientific paper. And if you look at the scientists who write, you know, in very esoteric subjects, they anyway write only for 5-6 people. They don't even have adequate names for affiliation. So I guess part of the question would be, you know, what are the ways in which a certain struggle to find a particular voice within that happens? So, so somebody like, you know, Phoebe Sother is a very, very interesting example because she has to say how, it's very clear from reading her book that she thinks she was bewitched. And that She's dying. And she said that, no, I don't have language by which I can tell, you know, the director of the journal say this. But she writes in a way that you perfectly understand what she's saying. Though she never uses that utterance in her process. She doesn't say anywhere, clearly I'm encouraged. She's saying, being in the bocage, there is no way in which one could stand outside. So, I mean, a lot of people have done that, and it's not something that can be formally easily ordered. In my experience as a teacher, it's really when the student feels I have to give expression to it, that we will find ways by which, you know, that can be allowed to flourish. And yet, you know, Coel has a very lovely thing where he says it's, you know, it's much easier to love eternally than to love tyrannically, right? And, you know, that's where I think we have to, I guess that's what Pindichan and Coel mean by saying that there is a diurnal existence in which I do have to take care of the fact that, you know, we must get a job, there's something comfortable and there's something published. And it's that I don't trivialize it. I think that that's very important. How one deals with it, you know, to preserve the soul for someone is to me the absolutely compelling question. And again, I can't give any formal answer. It's the kind of work that.
My question, and it's going to be brief because mostly in the life, my husband just completely ignorance of all this kind of thing that is absolutely delightful. My question is really what to do with why the choice of certain modalities, like just there are many modalities. So there is many modalities, the subjunctive modality. There's also the epistemic modality, and there's also the question of the aletheic modality, which is the one which is to judge or to know as true and false. So my question was essentially that I come from a formal linguistics tradition, but of course I recognize all the problems that language presents, in being the social and its inabilities to express the self. So the bottom line is, my question is about the universe. Because what the list that I can go ahead and talk about is the notion that we know life, that there are universals of life that we know, that belong to you every day, like the jaguar that lives in that body, that is why there are mistakes there. So from which modality does this notion of universe originate? So does it originate from a notion that I know that life in itself is not a unified entity? Right? That time in itself is not a unified entity. That notions of modality, like subjunctive modality, actually create unified entities in certain through ritual spaces, or the kind of spaces that we are, you know, inhabiting right now. That there are means by which, so there's the knowledge of the universe arise in a kind of absence? Or is does it arise from knowledge, which is an epistemic knowledge, that actually life has many forms? So, am I making myself clear?
I get the answer. Okay. So, for Wittgenstein, the question really becomes what that tractor wants to come back on. So, one of the examples he gives of the concept is the fact that we can say, oh, yes, this is how the why is it an example of concept? Because we know that, we can do that because we know that cheese does not, expand and shrink. Or the example that I give, Kant, you speak of course the spirit has a natural history of, of humankind, that they have words like words and spirits, who don't have the experience in which something like a head. We might expel that into some other world, or we might do something that happen. But if somebody said, I went to that particular tribe, he said, that's where excitement would be. That's the point. Without saying anything, he said, that's where the excitement would be. Right? And we would say, oh, maybe my world is one, or we might say, really, maybe they are different. If we know that people could go to the same world, then even something that puts the same world on.